Let's stand and turn to number 286. Number 286. I'm in the way, the bright and shining grain. I'm in the glory land plain. There ain't no world that Jesus saves in vain. I'm in the glory land plain. I'm in the glory land plain. Welcome you to our service this morning. As we open up, let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask His blessings over our service. Brother Tracy Pate, would you lead us in prayer, please, sir? Amen. You may be seated. Again, we say welcome to you to our service this morning here at Eastern Avenue. If today is your first time joining us, if you're a first-time visitor, if you wouldn't mind raising your hand, we're not going to embarrass you or call you out, but our ushers do have a getting acquainted card that they would like to give you. So if today is your first time joining us, just lift your hand. They'll give you that card as well as a pen to go with that. If you just mind filling that out and putting it in the offering plate when it comes by, just like to have a record of you being with us this morning. The flowers in front of me this morning are in memory of Mom and Dad of the Vickers and Watson's family, Brother Billy and Sister Martha Shiver, in memory of them, and we thank them for those flowers this morning. This past week, 13,000 plus copies of John and Romans in the German language were completed in our seed line work, and we will continue work this coming week, tomorrow night at 6:30, and then again on Thursday from 8 until noon in our seed line building, which is just to the west of our property, the tan metal building just on the other side of the main parking lot. You're welcome to join us any of those times. In the bulletin, it asks for some help this evening after the evening service to unload some scriptures from the trailer and into the building. but we've kind of adjusted that. If you're able immediately following this morning service, if you're able to help with doing that, if you could meet Brother Herb at the Seedline building, it shouldn't take but a few minutes if we can get enough good strong hands and backs and arms to get those things moved in. If you're able, just meet him over there following this morning's service. In Awana this coming Wednesday, it will be backwards night. Clubbers can earn extra points by dressing appropriately for that theme night, and we look forward to a great night in our Awana club. The Fishers of Men personal evangelism course will continue this coming Friday. We're thankful we had 15, I believe, this past Friday night for that course. Pastor Mendez is teaching that and how to win someone to the Lord on a personal basis. So if you're interested in that, you can still plan to attend if you would like. It meets on Friday night at 7 o'clock and will continue for the next 4 weeks. Senior Saints will meet this coming Friday at 11:30 in the Fellowship Hall. The theme is "The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows." There's a sign-up sheet to my left as well as in the foyer if you plan to attend. Meat will be provided, but we ask everyone bring side dishes and desserts to complete the meal. Mission St. Cloud will meet again this coming Saturday at 9:30 in the Fellowship Hall. That's the time where we gather together and then we walk the roads and the streets of our neighborhood, inviting people to join us here at Eastern Avenue and giving them some literature about our church, but most importantly, how they can know for sure that they're on their way to heaven. You can meet us on Saturday at 9:30 in the Fellowship Hall if you're interested in helping with that outreach. The CRAZE training that is coming up on the 4th of April, that's the civilian response to an active shooter event training. And again, all of our ushers, all of our security team members, and anyone who is involved in our children's ministry, from nursery all the way up to Sunday school and Awana workers, we encourage you to come for that training. Later on, we will have a training that we open up then to everyone in our church who would be interested in that. This morning, immediately following the service as well, if you are planning to attend the Bearing Precious Seed mission trip, that's going to take place in just a couple of weeks, going to Milford, Ohio to assemble some scriptures. Please see Pastor Callen in his office immediately following the service today for some information about that. Inside of your bulletin this morning, you have an insert. And this sheet of paper gives you all of the information. We're wrapping up our missions month from February. And so we wanted to provide everyone with information of how to contact our missionaries. We spotlight a missionary each week inside of our bulletin with their email address where you can reach out with a word of encouragement to them. Let them know they're being thought of and prayed for here at Eastern Avenue. But this will give you all of our missionaries' contact information if one of them comes on your heart, if God puts one of them on your heart. At a time where they're not in the spotlight of our bulletin, you can still reach out to them. So I encourage you to keep that handy and be an encouragement to our missionaries as God would lead you. And the most important announcement for me this morning is that we have a baby girl that we are holding and is home with mom this morning. Baby Soraya was born on Tuesday evening. She was 5 pounds, 7 ounces, 19 inches long. And like I said, she's doing great. They came home Friday, and we're just thankful to have them home and doing well. So we appreciate your prayers, all the calls, texts, contacts for us. We just are greatly appreciative of all the gifts that were given to us. Just beyond thankful, words can express our gratitude for everything that's been shown towards us. We're glad to see everyone this morning. Pray you receive a blessing from the service.
Turn to number 98. Number 98.
Thank you.
Let's stand and turn to number 103, and we'll ask ushers on this song. Number 103.
This morning and ask his blessings over the offering. With Mike Hulon, would you lead us in prayer, please, sir?
Over and over again.
seated.
You are my hiding place. You always fill my heart with songs of deliverance. Whenever I am afraid, I will trust in you. I will trust in you. Let the weak say I am strong in the strength of the Lord.
You are my hiding place. You always fill my heart with songs.
Trust in you. Let the weak say I am strong in the strength of the Lord.
I will trust in you.
Trust in you, you are my hiding place. You always fill my heart with songs of deliverance. Whenever I am afraid, I will trust in you. Trust in you. Let the weak say I am strong in the strength of the
Scott Beth. Beautiful song and beautifully done. Thank you so much. Let's turn in our Bibles this morning, if you would join me in the book of Acts and turn to Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10, we have just completed our missions month, and I chose to leave the flags up for today as a follow-up of the Missions Month. We have, I think, 36 flags on the wall that represent countries where our missionaries are serving and represent also countries where we have sent the scriptures through the Seed Line Ministry. And I praise the Lord for each of our missionaries. And I want you, if you would take that sheet that we've given out and begin to pray for our missionaries. Pray for them every day and contact them. Have a part in their lives and ministry. I wish that God could put upon our hearts, each and every child of God, that God could put upon our hearts a passion for missions. A passion for Bible missions. Bible missions is not going across the world, but it's going across our property line to the neighbors next to us. It's going to those that we come in contact with every day. And when we meet people, we ought to have that passion in our hearts to where we want them to know the Lord and Savior that we know. And we want them to know where they're going to spend eternity. And that's my prayer today for you, if you do not know Jesus Christ today, that we might be able to introduce Him to you, and that you might come to the place where you would trust Jesus Christ as your own personal Savior. This life is short, folks, and none of us has the certainty of tomorrow, and you need to be ready for when that day comes in your life, when you have that appointment with God, that appointment that comes at the end of this life. And if we knew when it would come, we would put off, I think, the right decisions until the very last. But unfortunately, folks put it off until it's too late. And I pray that God would convict your heart today if you're not saved, but I pray God would convict our hearts as Christians that we would have a passion to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with the world, with those that we love, those that we meet, and with those who are across the seas, that we would have that passion in our lives. Here in Acts chapter 10, there is a Bible account of Peter going to Caesarea, and we find here Bible missions being put into practice. Peter, even after sitting at the feet of Jesus, spending time with the Lord Jesus Christ, learning at His feet and seeing His instruction being put to work before them, even after all of that, Peter, I think, still had a very narrow view of the work of the gospel of Jesus Christ. When Jesus said, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature," as we read the passage this morning, we're going to find that Peter somehow thought that his responsibility was to preach only to the Jews. He had that narrow-mindedness, and God had to do something drastic in Peter's life to change his mindset and to get his thinking adjusted in the right way. And so let's look at, we'll start with a portion of the passage today. Verse 1 says, "There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian band, a devout man and one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. He saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of God coming into him and saying unto him, Cornelius. And when he looked on him, he was afraid and said, What is it, Lord? And he said unto him, Thy prayers and thine alms are come up for a memorial before God. Now send men to Joppa, and call for one Simon, whose surname is Peter. He lodgeth with one Simon a tanner, whose house is by the seaside. He shall tell thee what thou oughtest to do. And when the angel which spake unto Cornelius was departed, he called two of his household servants and a devout soldier of them that waited on him continually. And when he had declared all these things unto them, he sent them to Joppa. On the morrow, as they went on their journey and drew near unto the city, Peter went up upon a housetop to pray about the sixth hour. And he became very hungry and would have eaten. But while they made ready, he fell into a trance and saw heaven opened, and a certain vessel descending unto him, as it had been a great sheet knit at the four corners and let down to the earth, wherein were all manner of four-footed beasts of the earth, and wild beasts, and creeping things, and fowls of the air. And there came a voice to him, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "Not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean." And the voice spake unto him again the second time, "What God hath cleansed, that call not thou common." This was done thrice, and the vessel was received up again into heaven. Now when Peter, while Peter doubted in himself what this vision which he had seen should mean, behold, the men that were sent from Cornelius made an inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate. I invite you to bow with me for prayer today. Fathers, we've read the passage of Scripture. I pray, Lord, that you'll help me to think clearly as I preach the truth of your word. God, I pray that you'd guide my thoughts and my words. And Lord, I pray that the Holy Spirit would work in power in hearts today. Lord, I pray that you would help us as your children to develop a passion for the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Help us to develop a passion for missions and for missionaries and the work that you have called us all to do. Lord, again, we pray for those here today who have never trusted Jesus Christ as their Savior. I pray, dear God, today that you would speak to their hearts. Lord, I pray that someone might make the decision today to get things right with God and to know that their sins are forgiven, to know that they're on their way to heaven. Lord, our hearts are burdened for that, for the people that are here today, that each and every one would know Jesus as their Savior. God, we pray for our children as they are meeting today. Lord, I pray you'll do a work in their hearts. Bless the workers. And God, I pray that you'll help them as they teach the Word of God to the children today. Lord, we love you and we thank you for your goodness. We ask these things now in Christ's name. Amen. Here, Peter is somewhat misunderstanding of the responsibility that God has called him to as a Christian. Peter was a Jew, and he followed the things of Jewish law, and he saw the vision of the sheet coming down from heaven and all manner of different beasts in that vision. He said, "These things are unclean. These things are commanded that the Jews do not partake of." And Peter said, "I'm not going to partake of these things, Lord. I'm not going to do that because these things are unclean." And God responds to him. God says, "What God hath cleansed, that call not thou common." God rebuked Peter, and God set out to change his mindset. His vision was somewhat narrow-minded. He did not really understand and believe what the Lord Jesus Christ said when Jesus said to the Jew first and also to the Greek. He heard the first part, but he somewhat ignored the second part. And much like us today, Peter figured it was someone else's job to go carry the gospel to the world. Isn't that how we are today? Why, it's our job to come to church. It's our job to be a Christian right where we're at. But it's not our job to carry the gospel around the world. I know the Bible says that. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. But that's for the missionaries. That's for one whom God has separated. God has called out. God's called us all to be a missionary. God has called us all to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's possible that Peter had that preconceived notion and even some prejudice in his life as he thought about the Gentiles, those who were non-Jews. And he was perhaps so caught up with his own race of people that he didn't figure God wanted him to come out of his own little world. God surely doesn't want me to get out of my box, my circle of friends, my circle of influence. God doesn't want that for me. That is for somebody else. And God did something drastic here when he got Peter's attention. Now, I don't know about you, but if I saw a vision like this, I think God would get my attention. I've had a few visions, but that was after eating too much pizza late at night. But I think God could get my attention if something like this happened to me. Peter has some lessons to learn about the mission of the gospel. He has some lessons to learn about having a passion in his own heart for all the world. I think about the little song that we sang as kids growing up, sang it in Sunday school and church. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. That little children's you and I. We're His little children. And Jesus loves all of us. And Jesus went to the cross of Calvary to die for all of us, no matter what our background, no matter what our skin color, no matter what our nationality. Jesus died for all the world. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. He loved the world. And He said, go into all the world. And as much as we like to justify ourselves, I believe we too have some lessons to learn about gospel missions, about Bible missions. And I would to God that God would light that fire in my heart that it might burn and never go out. And I would to God for God's people here at Eastern Avenue Baptist Church that God would put that fire, that passion in our hearts for missions. Let's look what happened here in this chapter. The mission of the gospel calls for God's people to pray. Cornelius was a ranking soldier. He was a centurion. He was over a large number of men. And here's Cornelius, this influential man, and there's something that is missing in his life. The Bible says he was a devout man and one that feared God with all his heart, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. Cornelius was praying. He had a hunger in his heart for God. And I believe there was something missing in his life. And the Bible says he prayed to God always. He was seeking for God to fill that void in his life. And Peter had the answer. Peter had the gospel of Jesus Christ. But Peter, in his mindset, Peter said, those folks have to make it on their own. Those folks are on their own as far as me. I'm a Jew and I have no responsibility to carry the gospel to the Gentiles. And God changed Peter's heart. We have to notice here in verse 4, look at God's response towards Cornelius' prayer, the last part of the verse. Thy prayers and thine alms are come up for a memorial before God. God took notice of Cornelius' prayer. I'm glad there was a day when God heard my prayer. I knelt I knelt at an altar and I said, Lord, I'm a sinner. I've been in church all my life, but I realize I'm lost without Jesus Christ. And I want you to save me. I want to have eternal life. I want to know for sure that I'm on my way to heaven. And God heard my prayer that day. God saved me, and my life's been different ever since. I thank God that He heard this sinner's prayer. And God will hear your prayer today. And God heard Cornelius' prayer. And here's this man. He was religious, but he didn't know Jesus Christ. Then we see in verse 9, we see someone else praying. This is the man of God. This is Peter. And I don't know what he was praying. Perhaps he was a little self-righteous in his prayer. And on the morrow, as they went on their journey and drew nigh unto the city, Peter went up upon the housetop to pray. He went to that place where he'd gone before by himself and prayed to God. And that's when God spoke to Peter's heart. That's when God put a passion in his heart to reach the Gentiles, to reach the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know, I believe that Peter, in his prayer, I believe that day he sold out to the Lord. He said, first of all, he said, Lord, I'm not going to take that which is unclean. But God said, I've got a plan for you. There's something that's about to take place in your life, and you are going to understand what this vision was all about, because I'm going to change your mindset. I'm going to change your thinking. I'm going to put the fire of God in your life that the Gentiles also are to receive salvation, and that the Gentiles need the message of the gospel. And Peter experienced that day a change of heart toward the mission of the gospel and toward the religious teaching that had been in his life all those many years as he was taught the law under the Jewish law. And Peter demonstrated that day, he demonstrated an unconditional surrender to the Lord Jesus Christ. We skip on over in the chapter to verse 29. And Peter said there in verse 29, he said, therefore came I unto you without gainsaying as soon as I was sent for. Now we will read on here in just a moment. We'll read that passage, but Peter had a change of heart. He had something that turned things around. Look at it. Let's start with verse 17. Now when Peter doubted in himself what this vision which he had seen should mean, behold, the men which were sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate and called and asked whether Simon, which was surnamed Peter, were lodged there. While Peter thought on the vision, the Spirit said unto him, behold, three men seek thee. Arise therefore and get thee down and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. And I'll just pause there, folks. The matter of faith, when you make a decision to follow God, when you make a decision to do something for God, Satan's always going to be there throwing doubt at you. You'll make a decision and you'll step out by faith and you'll do something for God, and Satan's going to begin to hammer you and say, You really shouldn't have done that. You're going to fall flat on your face. You're going to look like a fool in front of all those that know you. No one's going to understand. Peter made a choice here. And we'll have to read on to see what happened. While Peter thought on the vision, the Spirit said unto him, behold, three men seek thee. Arise, therefore, and get thee down, and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. Then Peter went down to the men which were sent unto him from Cornelius, and said, behold, I am he whom ye seek. What is the cause wherefore ye are come? Peter at this point didn't know what they wanted. And he's asking them, why are you here? What is it that you want? Verse 22, and they said, Cornelius the centurion, a just man and one that feareth God and of good report among all the nation of the Jews, was warned from God by an holy angel to send for thee into his house and to hear words of thee. Then called he them in and lodged them. And on the morrow Peter went away with them, and certain brethren from Joppa accompanied him. Verse 24, and the morrow they entered into Caesarea, and Cornelius waited for them, and had called together his kinsmen and near friends. And as Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshipped him. But Peter took him up, saying, Stand up, I myself also am a man. And as he talked with him, he went in and found many that were come together. And he said unto them, notice this in verse 28, You know how that it is not an unlawful thing for a man that is a Jew to keep company or come unto one of another nation. Here's that background. Here's that teaching that Peter had all of his life. And Peter said, This is not right according to the Jewish law. I'm stepping out here by faith. I'm doing something that is contrary to everything that I had been taught all of my life. But notice the last part of verse 28. But God hath showed me that I should not call any man common or unclean. Therefore came I unto you without gainsaying, as soon as I was sent for. I ask therefore for what intent ye have sent for me. Cornelius said, 4 days ago, I was fasting unto this hour. And at the ninth hour I prayed in my house, and behold, a man stood before me in bright clothing, and said, Cornelius, thy prayer is heard, and thine alms are had in remembrance in the sight of God. Send therefore to Joppa, and call hither Simon, whose surname is Peter. He is lodged in the house of one Simon, a tanner by the seaside, who, when he cometh, shall speak unto thee. Immediately, therefore, I sent to thee, and thou hast well done that thou art come. Now, therefore, are we all here present before God to hear all things that are commanded thee of God. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, Of a truth, I perceive that God is no respecter of persons. But in every nation, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. Peter demonstrated an unconditional surrender to the Lord Jesus Christ. He said to God, Whatever it is that you want me to do, I will do it. And Peter went to the house of Cornelius, contrary to what he had been taught in his past life. He sacrificed and said, Lord, I surrender all. I will go where you ask me to go. I will do what you want me to do. I see here that the mission of the gospel calls for God's people to pray. If you begin to pray, Lord, what will you have me to do? God's going to give you an answer, my friend. You're going to come to a place where you have to make a decision. Am I going to follow my life the way I want to live my life? Am I going to do what I want to do? Or am I going to begin to follow Jesus? Am I going to surrender my wishes, my wants, my will for His will? Jesus Himself said, "Not my will, Father. Thy will be done." God calls us to that place where we need to surrender to Him. The mission of the gospel also calls for someone to preach the Word of God. We see it here. God asks the question in the book of Romans, how shall they hear without a preacher? Look, we stop with verse 35. Let's pick it up in verse 36. The word which God sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, He is Lord of all. Peter began to preach the message of the gospel to these people. The preaching is that of the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We look down to verse 39, and we are witnesses of all things which Jesus did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hanged on a tree. Him God raised up the third day and showed Him openly, not to all the people, but unto witnesses chosen before of God, even to us, who did eat and drink with Him after He rose from the dead. And He commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify that it is He which was ordained of God to be the judge of quick and dead, to give to Him give all the prophets witness that through His name whosoever believeth in Him shall receive remission of sins. Peter began to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. He began to preach how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that He was buried, and that He rose again the third day. I preached yesterday in a memorial service. Some of the folks are here today. But I preached on John chapter 14. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by Me." There is no other way to heaven other than through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, the cross of Calvary, and recognizing that God raised His Son from the dead. And Peter began to preach the message of the cross, to the message of the gospel. Paul said in Corinthians, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God." I thank God for the message of the gospel. I had opportunity to hear it over and over and over and over and over again. Hundreds of times in my life, I've heard the message of the gospel. And finally one day, God got a hold of my heart, made me realize I was lost on my way to hell. And God opened my eyes spiritually to the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. And I stand here today, I'm so thankful for that day in my life when God did that in my life. And I want you to know Jesus Christ. I want your spiritual eyes to be opened with the message of the gospel. You know, even as a little boy, God put in my heart a heart for missions. I wasn't even saved. I was growing up in church. I was listening to the accounts of the Bible and to the accounts of missionaries. I was sitting in a church where missionaries would come and present their work, and the church would respond by helping to support those missionaries. And God put that burden in my heart, even when I was unsaved, to have a part, to do something in the work of missions. Our mission field is to the world. Our mission, the mission is to carry the gospel to the world, but the gospel will never get to the world unless someone surrenders to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know, God may be calling some of our young couples here in the church to preach the gospel, to go to a mission field. God may be calling some of our teenagers to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. God may be calling some of us with gray hair to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. God in the book of Isaiah said, "Whom shall I send? Who will go for us?" And Isaiah answered, "Here am I. Send me." God immediately responded to Isaiah. God said, "Go and tell this people." You say, "Preacher, I can't go to Africa." Yeah, you can go across the street, though. "I can't go to a foreign field," but you can go today. You're going to go feed your face today. You can share the gospel of Jesus Christ with a waitress that waits on you. You can do something. We ought to pray, "Lord, what will thou have me to do?" And we ought to respond and say, "Lord, here am I. Send me. Send me. Use me." The mission of the gospel, and I'll hasten to close. The mission of the gospel, look at it again in verse 36. "The word which God sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, He is Lord of all, that word, I say ye know, which was published throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached." The word of God was published throughout all the world. And the publishing of the Word of God requires the participation of God's people. And there are so many ways that you and that I can participate in the publishing of the gospel. I've mentioned it already. Just taking today, stop back there by the track racks in the back and get you some gospel tracts and publish the Word of God by laying a track on the table or putting it in the hand of someone today and inviting them to come to a church such as this and inviting them to trust Jesus Christ. Encourage them to read the message in there and to trust Jesus Christ as their Savior. I was thrilled that 15 people last Friday night attended a class in learning how to win someone to the Lord Jesus Christ and being refreshed in being a fisher of men. And we can participate by witnessing to others, by sharing the gospel one-on-one with someone else. We can participate here in our church this coming Saturday by coming and going out with the others and going out and just handing out gospel tracts, handing out invitations, inviting people to come to church. We can participate in Mission St. Cloud. We can participate tomorrow night. You can participate after church today in the work of the gospel, picking up some of those bundles of scripture and setting out of the trailer and on the table in the Seed Line building. There are so many ways that we can participate as we assemble those scriptures. $1 pays for 5 scriptures. 5 scriptures. Those 5, John and Romans, each represent a soul that could receive the gospel of Jesus Christ for eternity. For eternity. Why wouldn't we give? What is so important in life that is more important than those 5 souls? Why would we not give? We can participate in the work of the gospel. Many of you here today participated in Missions Month by giving your tithes and your offerings to the Lord Jesus Christ. The result of our missions giving this past month, 41 missionaries will receive $1,600 extra support this month. What a blessing. What an encouragement that will be to those missionaries. You see, we can participate. You could participate by planning to go with us on the next mission trip. We're working on one for Honduras and one for next summer for South Africa. You could plan to participate. You can start saving your dollars right now, your pennies right now for that trip and going with us and joining us. Everybody ought to go to the mission field, to a foreign country. Just experience what it is like. We ought to participate, folks. We're coming up on Easter. Just a few days away. People come to church at Easter time when they won't come any other time of the year. What would happen if every family here today said, I'm going to get at least one in church on Easter. I'm going to get just at least one. I'm going to get somebody. I'm going to go after somebody I know or somebody I care about. Or I'm going to find a neighbor. I'm going to find somebody that will come to church with me on Easter Sunday and sit under the sound of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You see, we can participate in the work of missions. And a Christian needs to have in our lives, we need to have in our lives a passion for missions. Get to know. Take that list. Get to know your missionaries. Make friends with them. Get to know their family. Find out what their needs are and become friends with them in prayer, joining them in prayer. Prayer for missions will give anyone a passion for missions. Prayer will give anyone a passion for missions. The preaching of the gospel, the preaching of missions, calls for someone to surrender. Someone needs to surrender. The publishing of missions calls for everyone to have a part. Anyone, someone, but everyone. Every one of us here today, God's calling us to have a part in missions. William Carey was a great missionary to India for many years, spent 40 years of his life serving the Lord in India. He did much for the cause of the gospel of Jesus Christ, interpreting scripture, establishing hospitals, helping the farmers there, and just all sorts of things, establishing a school system. He was as a young man, 17 years old, he was a cobbler working on shoes, repairing shoes. And he despised God, but God got a hold of his heart. And he trusted Jesus Christ as his Savior. And then surrendered his life to go to India as a missionary. William Carey is known as the father of modern day missions. He made a great statement. He said, expect great things from God. Attempt great things for God. God promises to bless anyone or someone or everyone. God promises to bless anyone, someone, or everyone who will have a part in the work of gospel missions. I want to read you a verse. You don't have to turn to it. Numbers chapter 23 and verse 19 says, God is not a man that he should lie. We would all have to confess today that there was a time in our lives when we told a lie. Might be a little white lie, but there's a time in our lives when we did not tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. God is not a man that he should lie, neither the Son of Man that he should repent. Hath he said, And shall he not do it? Or hath he spoken? And shall he not make it good? God keeps his word. God tells us in the book of Philippians, God tells us in Philippians chapter 4 and verse 19, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Could I tell you who that's written to? It's written to those who are involved in the work of gospel missions. God said, I'll supply all your need according to my riches in glory. You see, whom God calls, God equips. God will help you if you'll surrender to him, and God will supply the needs in your life. God will supply the needs in Eastern Avenue Baptist Church. Oh, that we would have in our hearts and lives a passion for the work of gospel missions. Let's bow together for prayer. Lord, we thank you today for your precious word, and God, I pray that you'll take the message, Lord. I know it was simple, but God, I pray that it might touch hearts and lives today. Give us, Lord, that passion for your work. Give us a passion for the world, but give us first a passion for our neighbors and those around us here in our own city and in the places where we work, the places we do business. Help us, Lord, to have a passion for lost souls. Help us to see people as either lost and on their way to hell or saved and on their way to heaven. Help us to do everything that we can to reach the lost. Lord, I pray today for those who are here who are lost today. They've never trusted Jesus Christ as their Savior. They've never made that choice, that decision to accept Jesus and to receive Him and His forgiveness in their heart and life. Lord, that's not something that I can do or anyone else here can do. It's something that the individual must do themselves. And God, we pray that you do that work in hearts and lives today. Call us to you and help us to respond. Lord, if there's someone here today that needs to surrender to you, surrender their life in service, God, help them to be compelled, like Peter, to obey, to trust you. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Let's stand together, and as we sing today, if God is speaking to your heart, don't put him off. Step out and respond. You come as we sing.